Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this second set of two lectures about the awful problem of war and political violence, and what matters most, of course, how to curb it and how to make this present century more peaceful. I indicated 2 weeks ago that there are some counterintuitive findings about the victims of political violence. We all think that war among states is the worst thing that can happen and kills most of the people. There's an American political scientist, Richard Rummel, who painstakingly made statistics of people who died due to political violence, and his conclusion was that war is actually not the worst thing that can happen to people. The worst thing is a very suppressive and violent government. And this table shows it. It is not to discourage you, but to show you this particular picture of reality. There is a problem with the table, I must admit, because you see some countries appear three or four times in this table, because the statistics are about different periods, and I haven't figured out yet. I made this table out of his book, which has the telling title, Power Kills, Absolute Power Kills Absolutely, which is a play on the title, on the words of a famous British politician, Lord Acton, who once said, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely. Rummel turned it into power kills, absolute power kills absolutely. And he shows how dreadful violent dictatorships are. The top of the list starts with China in the period since the communist takeover. That estimate is disputed, incidentally. I wrote down in the footnote that the more recent estimate is 45 million and not 76. Still, these are horrible numbers. This includes the starvation and suppression during the so-called Cultural Revolution. Number two in the list is the Soviet Union, 62 million people. Also, this needs interpretation because it may include also a number of deaths during the Second World War. This figure, 62 million, is inferred by a British Soviet specialist who concluded from studying the demographic statistics of the Soviet Union how many people must have disappeared because of persecutions and, for instance, the forced hunger in Ukraine in the 1930s. Important to remember also when you try to explain why Ukraine takes such distance from the Russian Federation. 4.5 million people died in the 1930s in the so-called Holodomor, when Stalin wanted to force the population of Ukraine, mainly agricultural land, into collectivization. And they resisted this. And as a result, no food was allowed in that area. And for many Ukrainian families, this is very lively recent history. Then the third in the row is colonialism. The number 12 there, sorry that it's a bit unclear for those on the last row, but this is the way the statistics got into my presentation. About 51 million people. Then we all know about National Socialism, 21 million people, among whom were 6 million Jews. Now, it's important to look at this table because when we think about mass murder, many people think Hitler. He was not the biggest mass murderer in the 20th century. This is not to say anything that is good about him, but it shows you that reality often differs from what is in our mind's eye, what comes naturally to us about conclusions. What, of course, the three countries, China, Soviet Union, and Germany, have in common here is absolute power of the government and harsh suppression of the people also in peacetime. And it makes the point, which Rommel makes, that violent suppression outside war is even worse than the victims that fall due to war and civil war. Then you see a different figure about China that then deals with the period 28-49. Then Japanese imperialism, the killings by the hundreds of thousands, particularly of Chinese in Manchuria and elsewhere. Then you see again China, the struggle. It says here civil war and communism. It's basically the struggle that is more warlike between the nationalist Sun Yat-sen Chinese government and Mao Zedong and his troops. Particularly important is Cambodia. It's only 2 million people, but it was one third of the population. Small country where Pol Pot got power, had a philosophy, so-called philosophy, of agrarian communism. Everybody who had learned a profession, who was wearing glasses, who had some sort of education, was suspect. Everybody had to be equal and plant and harvest rice in a forced tempo, and it led to a massive killing. You may have seen the movie The Killing Fields. Yes?
Cambodia and the Khmer Rouge, apart from the, let's say, agricultural communism, Pol Pot was having, let's say, a quite radical, critical view of all educated people.
Yes.
Because his idea was revolution fails because of historical memory.
Yes.
So if you wear glasses, if you wear a watch, and if you are able to read,
exactly.
Therefore, I cannot erase your historical memory, then you should be...
You have to be erased, yeah.
And
yeah.
That was also...
Yeah. There's still a tribunal going on in Cambodia to get verdicts against some of the still living torturers and killers of that period. Then we get Turkey, particularly the Armenian genocide, which we may not call genocide. Vietnam, the struggle to establish a communist society. Poland, much worse than many people remember. The persecutions immediately after the establishment of communism in Poland. Pakistan, Yugoslavia. I draw your attention because many people think in Tito's time it was quiet. He was a good politician. He prevented the war in Yugoslavia. You see here the bill of Tito's harsh suppression. Some dictators are remembered in a better fashion than they deserve, which is not to say that anything good came out of the falling apart of Yugoslavia. North Korea, you know the story. I think that figure of 1.7 million people is an underestimation because there were very harsh starvation periods. Some people say at least 4 million North Koreans died because of lack of food due to political suppression. Then we see again Russian nationalism before the communist takeover. Then we see again the feudal and warlord time in China. I wish I could somehow combine these Chinese figures into something covering the entire period, but that takes a lot of statistical work and figuring out what the basis is of the different statistics by Rommel. Haven't found the time yet. Portugal, also quite high on the list for a small country. Indonesia, particularly after the Sukarno government fell and there was all of a sudden an enormous outburst of violence encouraged by the Indonesian authorities to kill so-called communists. Then we get into the rest categories, other democides. Note the notion, we talk about genocide and mass murder. Democide and politicide are notions coined by Mr. Rummel, saying governments killing systematically parts of their own population, or very directed particular political party members. Not genocide, which requires the intent to eliminate a specific racial or religious group. And then we get the total count, according to Richard Rummel, of the 20th century, which is 262 million people dead. Now, I remind you, the First World War killed about 25 million people, and the Second World War about 55 million people. So if these statistics are correct, Rummel's point is correct, that the worst thing that can happen to human beings is have a very suppressive, violent government. It shows, and that's the point, the relevance for this course, that there is a clear relationship between war and civil war and other forms of political violence. And I'll return to that in a minute. Then I try to distinguish different forms of so-called war. I said last time already that war, as we think with the notion of unified soldiers fighting each other, has gotten out of fashion. Yes?
Can you briefly explain how these numbers are estimated?
He studied painstakingly over tens of years the sources. And this is how he came up with these figures. I don't have all the footnotes here. They are from a book of mine where I put them all at the back of the chapter. But I draw your attention that the table is not yet perfect, because the reader would like to see, of course, these different periods of different countries somehow joined together. And the point is not whether it is 262 million or 213 or 275. The point is the magnitude of the problem. Let me go back to where we left the previous time. I think I should have noted it down, but we stopped for lack of time somewhere while I was dealing with a number of current conflicts, because of course this set of evenings should not just be about war and peace in theory, but also, if possible, link it to today and practice. You all know about the war in Syria and the war in Iraq. I mentioned briefly what nowadays, according to most people, are the tallies of victims, 250,000 people killed, 11 million fled, half of the Syrian population, almost 3 million of them in Turkey, and the rest in Lebanon, Jordan, Europe, different countries. Germany has taken in about 1 million refugees, part of them not from Syria. To my pleasant surprise, Canada announced the day before yesterday it would take in this year 305,000 immigrants out of this category, which is the kind of example we need to deal with this crisis. The war in Syria, as you know, is on the one hand the Assad regime supported by Russia, because Russia wants to protect an important naval base, and it has there a regime which is subservient to the Russian government. Stop me if I said it already previous time, no? And on the other side, you have various opposition groups. Very difficult to make sense of the picture. Many, many different groups, very divided. That's why it is so difficult for Western countries or other countries who would like to see peace in Syria to do anything about it, because who is going to form an alternative government? Which is not an excuse not to do anything, because in the meantime it gets worse and worse. What complicates the situation is that Turkey is fighting the Kurds violently, while we actually need the Kurds, who have a more or less autonomous region in northeastern Syria, to create areas where the population in Syria could flee to. Those are relatively safe. But the Turkish government, because it is fighting with the PKK, the Kurds inside Turkey, now was also bombing last week's the Turks on the other side, the Kurds on the other side of the frontier. And that complicates it tremendously and makes many, many more refugees. Part of it is, of course, also the Islamic State movement in Iraq, and the struggle between Sunni and Shiite political movements. Then we have a little bit further away still the trouble in Afghanistan. The Taliban is preparing for new offensives against the new Afghani government by Ashraf Ghani, who is a reform man, Western educated, former Minister of Finance, and will have great trouble in stabilizing the country. Further to the east, we have simmering violent conflicts or potential violent conflicts between China, Vietnam, the Philippines, Japan. The South Chinese Sea is full of resources. China is creating artificial islands to claim large parts of that sea and its resources. It is, of course, oil and minerals and other valuable stuff for the expanding Chinese economy that motivates them. But it leads to a clash between China and other countries. Traditionally, China and Vietnam are enemies. They have fought several wars in the past. And it may happen again, and then over properties in the sea. You know, the law of the sea says that you do not only have the territorial sea, which is 12 sea miles, as your property as a state, but also have the rights of economic exploitation of the sea, the resources under the sea, up to, I think, 200 miles. And the lines between coastal countries have to be drawn according to certain principles set in the international treaty about the law of the seas, and that motivates China to claim as much as possible by building artificial islands and raising the Chinese flag there and saying we are very peaceful, we only have fishing vessels here, but the fishing vessels have a big cannon on, and that's not to catch fish. And then we have in the same region, of course, the North Korean nuclear threat that you read about these days. Not a pleasant picture. Back to the Middle East. In Yemen is a war going on between the government of Yemen, supported by a number of other states to some extent, versus the Houthi tribe, which is supported by Shiites elsewhere and Iran. It's really it's not just a proxy war, it's also a local war. The Houthis wanted to take over the government in Yemen, but the different forces in the Middle East then join in the sides in favor of the sides they like, and then everybody is fighting everybody, and it kills many, many people. In Libya, you know the trouble, no effective government. Libya fell into five pieces after the NATO intervention. NATO forgot, and many political analysts forgot, that Libya was not a state, an area run by Gaddafi and his machinery. When that Gaddafi government was removed, Libya as a state disappeared. It was a very serious mistake, I think, to think that the new opposition government would by itself be able to form a new state. Because after this intervention, with all the arms deliveries to local groups, the local groups wanted to hold on to his arms and not give up. And there should have been, of course, a large-scale United Nations-led peace operation to integrate the country with international assistance, disarm these groups, take some of these groups into a new Libyan national army, turn others into policemen or other people with some form of job, but the whole Libyan economy fell to pieces, and so those who have guns continue to cling on to them and start to shoot each other and rob and steal. The United Nations now has negotiated between the two main groups a new government, but we still have to see whether it will be able to establish some hold over the country. And you may have read in the news that Italy, France and Britain are considering a military intervention because they feel very bothered by the fact that IS is getting stronger and stronger in Libya, in that chaos, profiting from the anarchy, and that IS comes very close to Europe. Moreover, it's a major source also of refugees, who the human traffickers, the people traffickers, flourish in anarchy, and they get enormous sums of people from the Sahel region and west and the Horn of Africa to make the crossing to Italy and other European destinations. At the same time, these countries hesitate because nobody likes to stick his hand into this hornet's nest, Libya, because you don't know where it ends. And you may have seen in the news yesterday that the Algerian foreign minister, who was visiting Minister Koenders in the Netherlands, warned against intervening militarily in Libya. I don't know what policy he would have to end this chaos. So it may come to an intervention anyway. Perhaps here too, the law of international politics applies, that things have to get much worse before anything is done about it. Because some problems have to become unbearably large before there is enough support for a joint action, because the world community is so slow in getting its act together. Then we have south of that great unrest. I talk here about the Lake Chad Basin, that is the whole group of countries south of the Sahara. Chad, East, West Sudan, Darfur, and other countries where there is great unrest because of tribal differences, because of increasing extremist vandalism, particularly in northern Nigeria, Boko Haram, you have seen in the news. And one reason is also the intervention in Libya, because that intervention in Libya freed enormous weapons stocks, which Colonel Gaddafi had, and they were spread all over the region before others could get hold of them and disarm these groups. So it has fueled a lot of violence south of Libya. The law of unforeseen consequences hit very hard in this intervention. Then we have the new country south of Sudan, South Sudan, the newest member of the world community, which split off from Sudan after a referendum. Not only trouble with the north of Sudan, but inside south of Sudan, different tribal groups and different political leaders who are struggling for power. Large stream of refugees. Close to that is also the trouble between Ethiopia and Eritrea. Eritrea has an extremely suppressive government, kind of North Korean type in Africa, where all men are pulled into military service, and that never ends. You go on and on and on and on till you are 50 and probably killed in one of the clashes. So the whole economy is focused on mobilization against Ethiopia. And the suppressive nature of this government continues to stretch also into the Netherlands. Eritrean refugees are supposed to be loyal to their government, and they are put under pressure by the embassy of Eritrea. They are supposed to pay taxes to Eritrea, and if they want papers, documentation, for instance, about their family members, they first have to sign a statement that Eritrea is a perfect country and that there is peace all over and human rights. And those declarations are turned over to the UN rapporteur about the human rights abuses in Eritrea. They also have a youth organization where young Eritreans are pulled into and groomed for nationalist propaganda. You have read in the last several months about trouble again springing in Burundi between Hutu and Tutsi tribesmen, and then the rest, one gets discouraged from this list, I have then as other simmering and potential conflicts. It's not at all complete, but it gives you a list of the urgency of the problem we are dealing with. Previous time, I sketched very briefly through maps international organizations which are supposed to help keep some order in the world system. We dealt with NATO, the European Union, the Council of Europe, the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, OSCE. In the meantime, China and Russia also have around them international organizations. The significance of their cooperation is not as strong as that of the EU and NATO, but they try to counterbalance the Western organizations. Here you have the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, which is mainly focused on economics, but the intent behind it is also to form a political group. You see, not everyone is eager to join, but it's useful, of course, to cooperate with your neighbors, even if you do that with great reluctance. There are a number of members who sooner or later will, or exceeding members who will sooner or later join. Interesting that Belarus, White Russia, as we say in Dutch, which is very subservient to Moscow, has not joined, but it talks to this organization. Then we have the Eurasian Union, which is Putin's plan. There, Belarus is a member. Ukraine is sketched here as a potential member. Well, it's not difficult to predict that it will not join voluntarily. And Georgia walked out, unwilling to join. South of Georgia is Armenia, which is a friend of Russia, and Armenia is supported by Russia in its struggle against Azerbaijan. You have read about the question of Nagorno-Karabakh, that large mountain area which is contested between the two. One of the unresolved so-called simmering conflicts in Europe. Simmering doesn't mean it is in the freezer. Last year about 70 people died there because of boundary incidents, and it is urgent to get that resolved. And then you have many of the stans that most of you in primary school geography lessons did not learn to distinguish. We have, with the fast moving developments in world politics, constantly look again at the map. Where again is Uzbekistan? Well, here it is. Many of those countries have very serious problems. You don't read about it because our press is not focused on it. Minority problems, frontier problems, suppression, efforts to legitimize the government with elections. Funny incident was in Kazakhstan, which is run by a dictator. He had elections, and he announced the very favorable election results already before the election was closed. It was a small mistake of his information office. And it was close to 98%, of course. It reminds us of a saying which people say was once pronounced by the Soviet dictator Stalin: it doesn't matter how people vote. What matters is how it is counted. Then south of us, we have this colorful map, which looks very pleasant, but you know it's a lot of trouble there. We talked about Yemen, we talked about Syria. We have not talked about the perennial problem between Israel and the Palestinians and other Arabs, which is not getting resolved. Lines on both sides are getting hardened year after year after year. We have had the so-called Arab Spring in Northern Africa. The only country which had a positive result was the small Tunisia. Tunisia, after long struggle and also some terrorist actions inside Tunisia, was able to adopt a democratic constitution. But it is very threatened now by terrorist attacks, which the aim is to drive away tourists and hit the Tunisian economy. And close to here are ISIS camps, and many young Tunisians cross the border and join ISIS, and there is a lot of fighting here. So the trouble in Libya affects Tunisia too. It is strange that Western countries do not assist Tunisia more, as the only country that was able to turn its Arab Spring into a real democratic reform. Relatively stable is Morocco. There's something funny. The from a democratic point of view, the Arab countries with monarchies are more stable than the Arab republics. Morocco, Saudi Arabia, many people hope, we don't know. It's really run by 1,500 princes. And how long will they be able to control this? It works with the West, but it also at the same time works against the West, because it finances many madrasas and rather extremist organizations all over the world. There's something very two-faced in this regime. A partner is Jordan of the West and Oman. Those are all monarchies. This is not to say anything in favor of a monarchy. It is perhaps an accidental, perhaps as not accidental, that in a way, you know, human psychology, it is easy to identify with the fairy tale of princes and kings and princesses than with elected politicians. Much of the trouble here is then in this basin, the Chad basin, and Sudan. I talked about Darfur. We talked about this, Eritrea and Ethiopia. Basically, very similar people, not much reason for tribal conflicts. Very little influence of radical Islam. Most of these people are Christians, Coptic Christians. The underlying common cause of much of this trouble is simply power struggle. And for power struggle, you use the arguments that you can find. Ethnic differences, religious differences, historical grievances. We'll come to the sources later on. Here again, a picture of Libya as it is more or less today. You have read about it in the newspapers. This is the area that I talked about that would lend itself for a haven for refugees from the rest of Syria, were it not for the struggle with Turkey about the Kurds. The Kurds here were able to steer away from much of the violence in the first years of the war in Syria, and they used the opportunity of the weakness of the Assad government to have their own order here, like the Kurds did in northern Iraq. You know, the Kurds are divided, a divided nation, if you want, group, over four countries, divided by history and treaties. And you have them in Iran, in Iraq, in Turkey, and in Syria, and some groups also elsewhere. The struggle nowadays is particularly here. You have read about the destruction of Aleppo and large streams of refugees up north. This is what motivates the Russian Federation. Mr. Putin doesn't want to lose his harbor here, his naval base at the Mediterranean. And poor Lebanon, one of four people there is a refugee from Syria. The green is the area where Assad's troops are boss, but the rest is still very contested with many, many rebel groups. This is more or less empty, this area. It says Islamist and jihadi groups, but that I think is this light blue version, and there are few people living here. This is, much of it is desert. Then again, a piece of the map of Ukraine. You know that Crimea and Sebastopol were taken away by Russia. The two countries still fight about it. I happened to be yesterday in Vienna at a meeting of the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe, and there were really very strong exchanges between the Soviet and the Ukrainian ambassador. It is, of course, a clear violation of international law to annex a piece of another state, notwithstanding the history. I mean, this all used to be part of the Soviet Union, but it was part of independent Ukraine when Ukraine became independent. And Putin plans, a bridge here to connect it to Russia. And it's important for this harbor. We are here in the Black Sea, and from here he can, of course, go into past Turkey into the Mediterranean, and then it is handy to also have a warm water port in the Mediterranean, Latakia in Libya. Here you see also the Donetsk area where the Russian encouraged rebels have established their own republic, and we see more of that in the next picture. This Mariupol has been taken, in that sense the map is not entirely correct anymore, taken back by Ukraine, but the rest is really Russian-dominated area now. We have observers there of the OSCE, the people in white suits and white vehicles who are unarmed but ride around to report what is happening. They don't see what happens at night, of course. And they don't see all that much. I think nowadays you see much more through electronic means and teledetection with satellites. And there are governments who know quite well what happens here. Then another country which was dismembered as like Ukraine because it was interested in NATO membership is Georgia. Already before the talk about NATO membership, Abkhazia became a Russian protectorate. It wanted, the leaders at least, there was no election or so, wanted to be independent, so they split off from Georgia. It is a rather European country. Its population very much wants to belong to Europe and the West, and it had for a long time a president who wanted to sign immediately for NATO membership, and some Western leaders promised it to Georgia. And if I may add a personal opinion, that was very unwise because that invited destabilization. Because this is not what Putin likes. This used to belong to the Soviet Union. Stalin was born here. And Putin admires Stalin. When the Soviet leader, Georgian leader got so angry about Russian meddling and destabilization that he attacked Russian troops, he committed a very serious political mistake because then he got full-blown all-out war with Russia. And Russia, as a result, took away South Ossetia by declaring it independent, but it's really a Russian-dominated state. So that teaches a lesson when you are, let's say, a rabbit sleeping next to a bear, you should not kick the bear in his back at night, because sooner or later the bear will turn and hit you. And NATO, of course, couldn't do anything because, or didn't do anything because it was not going to go to war against the Russian Federation to save little Georgia. So Georgia is now on its own, and I think the best possible thing for a country like Georgia and Ukraine being so close to Russia is to follow a very careful neutral policy. Remember how Finland solved its big problem during the Cold War. Finland had fought a war against Russia, the Winter War, before the Second World War. Russia took some parts away, and the Finnish became very careful, and they focused entirely on their domestic development as an economy and a governance system. They built a modern state, but they kept their voice low, and they were neutral. When the Cold War was over, Finland arose as a very modern, strong European country. Then they had the room to spread their wings. And this was often in a critical fashion in the West called Finlandization. When you keep your voice low and a low profile in order to protect yourself, I think it holds a lesson for countries like Georgia and Ukraine. Focus on your domestic development and your strength, and do not talk too much about membership of Western organizations. I'm not talking now against possible economic association with the European Union. That's something very different than membership of NATO. Then an entirely different sphere, which you don't look at normally when you think about East, West, North, and South, and that's the North Pole. There, East and West are meeting each other and have a lot of common interests. This is what it looks from the top. We are here somewhere. This is the Netherlands. The countries which own, so to speak, the North Pole, which is not a country but an ice mass, getting smaller and smaller year by year, incidentally, they have economic exploitation rights. This is the sphere of Norway because Svalbard belongs to Norway. Denmark and Greenland have a big piece, and the Chinese, who have a long-term vision, are buying large pieces of land here because they know there's a lot of energy and precious metals under the ground. And with the melting of the northern ice cap, one day, if you buy property there, you'll be rich. United States is involved because of Alaska. You see how then here the law of the seas divides these spheres. Russia is the biggest partner here. And although the North Pole is not at all Russian property, the Russian Navy planted under the sea the Russian flag to say this is ours. All other states, there is an Arctic Council in which they talk to each other, said, no, no, this is not your property. And actually, Denmark claims that. It's not outright conflict now. And notwithstanding the tensions with Russia over Ukraine and Georgia and other areas in Eastern Europe, in this sphere there is still decent talking to each other in the Nordic Council, in the Arctic Council. But there are many naval ships moving under the ice mass, submarines, also with nuclear weapons. Some energy giants prepare themselves for pumping up the oil, which can have disastrous environmental effects, because an oil spill in the Nordic, in the Arctic Sea, is not solved by nature like it is in some other regions, like it was in the Gulf of Mexico. This is so cold that nature itself cannot handle, not break down with sea bacteria oil spills. So it would be very, very polluting, and that's why organizations like Greenpeace are vehemently against the exploitation of the Arctic region. But we don't know what happens. The major powers are so much in competition over energy resources that those interests may, in the end, prevail over environmental care. Then to a different area. It looks a bit disjointed, what I'm telling you, but it all fits into the pattern, yes? Yes.
The United Kingdom doesn't want to give up the Falkland. It's almost on theory useless island, but due to thanks to Falkland, the United Kingdom can claim a certain.
Well, the Antarctic is quite different from the Arctic region because there is a treaty about the Antarctic which formally takes it out of the struggle among different states. There is a treaty to which the treaty signing states are committed that it is to be preserved, not to be exploited, and that only scholarly research is allowed there. Up till now, I think, I'm not too optimistic by saying that there is not such a jockeying for position as there is in the northern pole region. And it is a much thicker layer of ice. From an environmental point of view, it's different from the North Pole. The North Pole is slowly melting. I have talked to scholars who have figured out what happens if, after the North Pole melts, climate change is accelerated because less and less sunlight is reflected then by the northern, the white North Pole cap into the space, into space, and then the Arctic would melt. And when the Arctic melts, I think we all have to move to the Vaalse Berg because that will increase the sea level by 80 meters. That's quite a different story than the North Pole. But that would completely change the Earth's environment because we assume in all these pictures about environmental change that more or less the currents in the seas will remain the same. We assume in the Netherlands that it will get a little bit warmer here because of climate change. But what happens if the Mexican warm Gulf Stream changes its current, which is now very much related to the North Pole? You know, North Pole, melting ice, going south, returning, warmed up by the Gulf of Mexico and keeping us much warmer than we would be otherwise because we live at the height of northern Canada. So maybe future generations will get a little bit colder than we are. We don't know. That's a reason the more to be very careful with climate change than we have been up till now. Now back to the subject of military power and conflict, it's interesting for you to see where the big spenders are as far as military expenditure is concerned. As a percentage of gross domestic product, then you see that the United States and the Russian Federation and some countries in Northern Africa and Saudi Arabia, some countries which are not threatened at all by external intervention, are also big spenders. Sometimes high defense expenditure has nothing to do with international threats, but has to do with regime security. A regime spending enormous sums on its own security apparatus, defending itself against the population. Of course, here this has to do with the ongoing civil war in Colombia. This has to do with the pretensions of the claims of Saudi Arabia to be a big regional power in competition with Iran. This picture more or less confirms the image you have from the news about where the big spenders on military equipment are. Here you see an aspect of it, the top weapons exporting countries, which are again the big fellows. The Netherlands is also among them, relatively speaking, because we have some industry producing parts for modern weapon systems and exporting it. The great sources of the weapons which cause most of the victims every year, small arms, are Russia and China. Russia with the Kalashnikovs and China with reproductions of Kalashnikovs, which are unfortunately as effective as the Russian original. And they poison all of the world. Most states are overflowing with weapons. Here you have the top 15 defense budgets in the world. Interesting, the United States spends more than all of the NATO, other NATO countries together. And in the American view, that is the responsibility of the United States to be chief policeman in the Western world. And the United States wants to remain number one, and it invests tremendously in military technology. It invests so much that other countries which also want to be modern in military technology, like the United Kingdom and France, really cannot keep up this competition. And that's why countries like the Netherlands like to buy American equipment for the defense forces, because then you get the newest of the newest. You see that a country without a defense organization, Japan has quite a defense budget. And it's rapidly growing in view of the threat it perceives from China. Number two in military spending. The Netherlands is not on this list. It spends now 1.1% of GDP on defense, which is very much on the low side if you compare it to other NATO countries. And if you take as your position that security in NATO is a collective good, which has to be the result of collective efforts. And that makes the United States quite frustrated that its European partners don't do all that much. Okay, now I have made up with the backlog of the last lectures a week ago, and we can go into the subject scheduled for today. Contemporary armed conflicts. How are we doing on time? I think we should perhaps have a brief break. Yeah, let's break for 10 minutes. This shows what I intend to do tonight. Part of it we have dealt with already, the tally of victims in the 20th century of political violence. I say here contemporary armed conflicts. That's a much wider notion than war. It also includes civil war and criminal and economic violence on a large scale. I want to skip tonight the economic damage estimates. They are available, but I would like to move into the causes of armed conflicts, because a good analysis of that is important, of course, for the diagnosis of the pathology of violence in the world system and how to arrive at policies that curb this this violence. So let's go first to the manifestations of violence, different kinds of wars. There are, of course, the interstate wars, like wars between two countries, between many countries, between alliances. If there had been a war between East and West, the NATO and Warsaw Pact in the nuclear period, which would have been extremely destructive, it would have been between two large alliances. And we wouldn't be sitting here if that had happened. The world escaped that risk. It came a couple of times very close to the nuclear exchange, particularly in the Cuba Missile Crisis. And it also came close one time when there was a misreading in the Soviet Union by a new equipment, which led to the conclusion that the United States had fired nuclear missiles at the Soviet Union. And the colonel who was in charge of watching this in the Soviet Union decided that it was not sure. And he decided to ignore this rather than launch nuclear missiles from the Soviet side to NATO. Sometimes very, very big decisions depend on just the decisions. Very, very important events or their avoidance depend just on a single human being's decision. to illustrate that also from the side of political leaders in the Cuban Missile Crisis, in I think it was in 1962. You may remember from the history books that the Soviet leader Khrushchev had installed or was in the process of installing nuclear missiles on Cuba, aimed at cities on the eastern side of the United States. When the United States discovered this, this was the Kennedy administration, the first response was of his advisors, bomb the hell out of the place so that the Soviet Union cannot place these missiles. To the great benefit of John Kennedy, he ignored that advice. And he also ignored a very stern warning by Soviet leader Khrushchev that he would launch nuclear war against the United States if the United States acted against Cuba. And Kennedy did something very smart. He waited, did not respond to this very warlike warning. And then Khrushchev, having slept a few nights over the problem, sent a second message, which showed a lot of human concern for the consequences of nuclear war. And Kennedy ignored the first negative message, and he only responded to the second positive message, saying both of us have our interest in avoiding a nuclear exchange between the two giants. And he decided not to take action against the Soviet missiles directly, but put a naval blockade around Cuba so that Soviet ships bringing further equipment would not reach Cuba. And then some people still thought it will be war. Many civil servants in Washington sent their families out far into the country thinking this weekend we may be bombed. Khrushchev decided to give his ships the order to return, and he did not test the will of the United States to really enforce this naval blockade. So that's how the world, according to some people, escaped narrowly a nuclear exchange. And in the end, the Cold War was a period without war between the two giants. There were many wars in many other areas in the world. But the fear, the common fear of the system that was called MAD, MAD, Mutual Assured Destruction, that common fear was so strong that it kept both sides very careful. And the MAD system, it's good to mention it because many people tend to forget it now, was based on the threat of a second strike. The nuclear arms of both giants were such that neither of the two sides could knock out all nuclear weapons from the other side in a first strike. Part of the nuclear weapons were invulnerable for a first strike. They were constantly flying or constantly at sea. It's very difficult for us to imagine that 36 years ago, constantly airplanes with nuclear weapons were starting in Russia and in the United States, flying to the other side with weapons and being called back. Week after week, so that the other side would know I can never surprise and eliminate the other side. He will hit me again with so-called a blow from the grave. It's very morbid language, but the system created a power balance that kept the two sides at negative peace against each other, negative peace in the sense of no direct violence. It worked. Fortunately, some people say, is it an improvement that we are now without a Cold War, but have many regional and local wars in which many people die? by the tens of thousands every year. That's up to you to judge. The great risk of the Cold War was, of course, this small chance of a completely destructive war, which really would have altered the environment and led to a nuclear winter because of all the pollution, the dust, the destruction, the radiation that would have, the victims of such a war would have been tremendous. Now, that period, fortunately, is over. I don't know whether it may return. One doesn't know. It doesn't look like that, I think. I think the big players are wise enough to avoid a direct military confrontation against each other because nobody knows where it ends and may end in self-destruction. The risk nowadays is the weak states, the failing states, the anarchic states, who cannot control their own order, their civil wars, and the spread of civil and local wars into big proxy wars. Now that brings us to the real problem nowadays, that is domestic wars. I call it here uncivil wars because they're extremely destructive. And 90% of the victims of a modern war are not at all soldiers, they are civilians. And the only organization we have in the world to maintain the peace is the United Nations, and it was not at all designed to make peace in civil wars. It is there, the whole charter sees at interstate war, not intrastate war. So the United Nations had to improvise how to deal with the many civil wars in the world. And it's no incidence, it's no coincidence that the number of civil wars increased tremendously after the Cold War was over, because the tension in the Cold War had a disciplining effect on many states. You belonged either to the Western camp or the Eastern camp, formally or informally, or to the group of non-aligned. And that psychological confrontation, which had an ordering effect, is gone. That's why we live also in such an unruly and unpredictable political, global political system. Now, why these domestic wars? You know the reasons. I enumerate them here. Tribal wars. I showed you the map of Africa with all these different groups, which do not coincide at all with the country borders. That also applies to many parts of Asia. There are religious wars. There is a lot of economic violence. There is a lot of, I call it, other criminal violence. Armed groups who profit from chaos to commit the crimes, rob, steal, rape. And then there are other manifestations of military power. On the positive side, peacekeeping, efforts to keep the peace among members of the United Nations, not all of them successful, some of them disastrous, but we should not forget also some successes. And there is the formal possibility of the United Nations enforcing peace with soldiers from its member states on warring parties, like the liberation of South Korea when North Korea overran South Korea, like the first war against Saddam Hussein after he had overrun Kuwait. Now, what are the causes of all this violence? You can make an endless list. You can categorize them in many ways, and this is a somewhat unorganized list, which I think does have the benefit of including most possible causes. Statistically, most wars happen in times, this is the result of statistical analysis since the beginning of the 19th century, all wars. Most wars happen in periods of rapid power shifts, of instability. And it's often that those who are in a losing position in power shifts become belligerent. It's a correlation, it's not a cause. One of the reasons is dissatisfaction with the status quo. Example, Germany, Japan, Italy in the 1920s and 30s, dissatisfied with the status quo, wanting to upset it, walking out of the League of Nations, preparing for war. Now, if that is a lesson, we should take it to heart now, because we also have dissatisfaction with the status quo in Europe now. It's Russia with a trauma, the loss of the big empire, Soviet Union. And it's very dissatisfied with the status quo. It wants to restore as much as possible. And that's why it tries to eat away parts of countries which are now independent and used to belong to the Soviet sphere. We don't know how long this will go on. That depends very much on the response, of course, whether or not Putin learns that it doesn't pay to commit aggression against neighboring states. And that depends on the response of Western states. I'm not talking about military action. Nobody will be so out of his mind to undertake military action against Russia, which is a nuclear power. But, of course, Russia has been hit by other means of pressure, an economic boycott led by the European Union and the United States, which is hurting the Russian economy very badly. And you see a very contrary development in Russia. The economy goes down like this, and the defense expenditures go up like this, which causes an enormous finance gap for Mr. Putin, which he doesn't seem to be worried about. But it would be worrisome to me if I were a citizen of the Russian Federation. Somehow, this will cause grave problems. Now, what drives those who are dissatisfied with the status quo? They think in terms of spheres of influence. They think we improve our national position if we have more territory, if we have more population under our control, and if we have buffer zones between us and potential enemies. And that, I think, explains much of the thinking in the Kremlin. Spheres of interest. Now, the United States also thinks in spheres of influence. It wouldn't like to have a Russian-controlled government close to its borders. But this thinking in terms of coercive sphere of influence is very prevalent in Russia nowadays. It is prevalent in most of history. It's the classical approach to international relations. You should gather as many sources of international power as you can, because all is a power struggle. This is the so-called realist theory of international relations, thinking that basically it is a power struggle. Because there is no world government, it is everybody on his own, and everybody is after his national interest, and national interest is translated in security interest. This is the gloomy view of international politics. There's also a strong economic element. Everybody's looking for energy resources and precious metals and minerals and water resources, I add. I said already the previous time that by 1950 we need to feed, by 2050, we need to feed a world population of 9.3 billion people, which will require 70% more food production than we have nowadays. Where do we get it from? The most crucial material is fresh water. Then we have, of course, the obvious cause of a lot of violence, tribal rivalries and division of tribes by frontiers drawn in the past, often by other powers, often by colonial powers. As a result, the wish of some groups of people to separate from the state they belong to and join another state, secession, or become independent, example, the Kosovar people, who seceded after the NATO intervention in their favor from Serbia. Then we have the general wish of self-determination. That sounds nice, self-determination, sounds very democratic, but it's a very dangerous notion, because the notion that we all have to be homogeneous nation states, speaking one language, having one type of people, having one common culture, means global civil war. If you divide the world population into such nation groups according to national identity, you would have something like 5,000 or 6,000 states. Not very smart to strive for such a form of self-determination. We have to accept, and that's one of the requirements of peace, that we are all pluralist states with different people, different backgrounds, different interpretations, different views of history, different beliefs and ideologies. Some wars are the result of unclear borders. Now, if you have an unclear, unresolved border question, the wise and smart solution is, of course, to go to the World Court in The Hague and ask for a legal ruling. Then you can save a lot of effort and risk if you commit yourself beforehand to the verdict of these wise lawyers. But most governments don't. They want to keep the cards in their own hand and not leave this question to the lawyers. We know the importance of ideology as a cause of war and closely related religion. Ideology is a secular religion. Another entirely different cause is the widespread possession of firearms. When you calculate correlations, statistical correlations between wars happening and other phenomena, characteristics of countries, there are two strong correlations. The possession of firearms among the population, which is logical, because when you can upset the power balance in the country and you find a reason to do so and you are a political leader who is motivated to do so, when you have many armed people, then you have a chance to overthrow the government. Another relation, correlation between civil war and phenomena is a youth bulge. Many young men, particularly if they are unemployed. And if you look at our present demographic buildup in the world, we are not in a good spot. And that may be an underlying cause of a lot of the unrest we have in the Middle East and in Africa. Then we have, of course, in many countries, hatred among population groups and against neighbors, passed to suppression and deprivation, often economic deprivation, gross inequalities. Hatred due to cultivation of assumed historical injustices. My apologies for the spelling mistake in historical. Good example is, for instance, this Serb idea that they lost the battle, I don't know what the English term is, the battle at the Mirelfeld, in 1390 so much, and that is cultivated, this lost battle, and it's a source of nationalism. Now, many countries have their own interpretation of history and often then cultivate certain what they see as historical injustices or historical rights. Imagine the Italians would say, we used to own the Netherlands in the period of the Roman Empire, so we are now capturing Amsterdam. It's our historical right. There is another people who reasons like that and has a piece of the Middle East. I hope I don't offend anybody, but it is, of course, a strange way of reasoning that where your kind of people used to live 2,000 years ago gives you a right to take that area away from the people who lived there in the 20th century. Also, in present Russian Federation, you have this assumed historical injustice. I talked recently to some Russian scholars, and they said, after the Cold War, we got the Versailles deal, the short end of the rope. I was surprised by that reasoning, because who invoked that reasoning? Versailles, the Versailles trauma, Adolf Hitler. That Germany had gotten the short end of the deal. And when you now hear Russian people saying that, suggesting they have lost a war and they were given a bad deal, that is very dangerous thought. And it's very important for us to communicate with them to say this is not right. NATO did not win the Cold War, the old NATO powers. If you want to think in terms of losers and winners, there's only one category of winners. Those are the Central European people who achieved self-governance and some degree of democracy, and then later on decided voluntarily to join Western organizations. They were not forced to do so. That was their choice. But it's difficult to accept for people with this so-called Versailles trauma about the end of the Cold War. But it shows how important communication is, just talking to each other and also trying to imagine why certain people have some form of trauma or almost a neurotic view of history, because it can be the source of violence. And this is not just a question for politicians, it's also a question for historians, for poets, who sometimes cultivate these national feelings. Remember, Karachi is a poet. And this image of history and your own identity, having been harmed very badly by others and justifying taking it back by violent means or with driving out others, like happened in Bosnia, is very dangerous. That's why I mentioned here collective trauma. Much of international politics is like social psychology. And I think it helps to analyze politics among states in terms of psychology or psychiatry. Sometimes also more or less psychotic leaders rise because of common trauma. They appeal to others. And that is related to this drive to restore a past of greatness and empire which was lost and has to be rebuilt. Was a factor also in Saddam Hussein's thinking. This big empire in the past, long time ago, I have with harsh measures to recreate the past if I can. It plays a role in Moscow. It played a role in other states. It means you don't accept the status quo. You want to upset it, and if necessary, use violent means. The factor fearing power loss, I mentioned already when I said that the perception of a rapid change in the balance of power or the distribution of power is associated statistically with a high incidence of war. And what is associated also is the perception by the population of large-scale corruption. That was a very important source in a number of civil wars, the fact that the government had lost all credibility and that many unemployed people were so intensely angry about their deprivation relative to the rich upper class that they resorted to rebellion and also armed rebellion. There are more causes. environmental threats may become a cause of war. Hundreds of millions of people may go on the move in the future in South Asia and Africa. I mentioned already large unemployment. Large streams of refugees are associated statistically with a high chance of war. Racial discrimination and suppression, clear, and superiority claims by one people over others. And then again, this factor, power imbalance or rapid shift in the distribution of power. You can say in a way that most of what is wrong in our world is the inclination of those who are in power to abuse their power, be it political power, military power, economic power, media power, scientific power. It's a natural tendency of people. Once you have power, you like to use it and enlarge it. It's like a drug, and you want more of it. In a democracy with a rule of law state, we have good medicine against it, and that is the legal system. And a full rule of law system brings also the powerful under the rule of law. In the Netherlands, it's very stupid to go into abuse of power because you're finished as a politician. When this gets noted by parliament, by the media, you have to stay strictly within the law. There are many systems where it is not noticed or regarded as quite normal that those in power use their power for personal gain or to advance the position of their kind of people, their tribesmen, their religious followers. A solid power balance inside the country is one of the requirements of a rule of law system and of democracy, where no particular element of the state can overpower the others and start to dominate. And that also applies internationally. This is the lesson of the so-called realist school of international affairs, that you seek safety in a power balance. When you see a very powerful country and you feel threatened, you make friendship with and conclude a treaty with another country that may feel threatened, and the two of you work together so that you balance off the threatening power of the other. The realist school says this is the solution, the only available solution. International organizations are not strong, they cannot guarantee peace, international law is not enforced. It is balance of power. It has a certain appeal. The problem is it doesn't work. If balance of power were a good insurance against war, the First World War would never have happened. It was a balance of power system in Europe, a multiple balance of power system, with treaties and alliances between different states. If you are attacked, I come to your defense. Your enemy is my enemy, and the friend of my enemy is also my enemy. And that kept the system in the 19th century quite a long time in peace, with the great exception of the Franco-German War in 1870. And the First World War should never have happened, according to the balance of power theory. But it happened anyway, and it is seen by many historians as a great diplomatic accident, a traffic accident. Nobody wanted that war, it happened anyway, and one of the reasons that that war arose was military draft and mobilization. When you are concerned about the attentions of your potential enemy and you see that he is worried and starts to mobilize his forces, you say, he may plan a surprise attack, so I'm mobilizing my forces too. And so this system of competitive mobilizations and war preparation probably worsened very much the tensions which existed in 1914 and led to a war that nobody had foreseen, industrial modern war with the trenches and the firepower and destructive power of defense organizations of that period. Now, let's get to what to do about it. How to establish peace. Peace has two notions, negative peace and positive peace. Negative peace is the beginning of positive peace in the sense that it is the absence of shooting each other. Peace begins with ceasefire, armistice. Then you can talk to each other. There are some forms of negative peace which are simply the result of victory. One side beats the other side, and that's the end of it. That is conquest, and then it is so-called peace. Sometimes scorched earth, sometimes massive destruction, sometimes mass murder and genocide. Many peace initiatives spring from a military stalemate. Both sides are exhausted after a lot of fighting and victims. And then they are finally ready to talk to each other and see if they can protect what they have gained in the war or what they fear they are losing if the war continues further by talking to each other. Then it helps if other parties mediate and try to talk sense to the warring parties. Then it helps if the United Nations orders a peace operation to keep these sides out of each other's hair. It helps if the United Nations says, we take over now, and those who do not abide by the rules of a peace deal will be met by United Nations-led soldiers with all the wherewithal to make war against these soldiers, and in diplomatic language, that is enforcement. That basically is the solution that underlies the theory of the United Nations, collective security. If someone breaches the rules, commits aggression to against another state, then we all, as UN members, have to be led by United Nations Security Council resolution and take action to restore this aggression and to restore the normal status quo. Then I have in this list also the balance of power as possible means to achieve negative peace. It has worked during some periods, and it has a certain logic which appeals to political leaders. The downside of the balance of power is, of course, arms race. It depends, a stable balance of power depends on correct observation, correct perception of the other side. If you think he has many more weapons than he actually has, you feel urged to strengthen your own defenses, and that action may lead the other side to increase his defense spending. And so it becomes bidding against each other in a more and more expensive and dangerous situation, which happened in the Cold War. It's unimaginable, but there was a period that we had 50,000 large nuclear weapons altogether from both sides aimed at each other. Tremendous destructive power. Now, one way of playing the balance of power game and protecting yourself when you are a smaller power is, of course, to seek alliance, conclude a treaty with bigger states which help you to protect yourself. That's what the Netherlands did in 1948 when it concluded the Brussels Treaty with five other states in Europe, and then 1949 when it entered NATO, when basically the United States joined this European alliance and turned it into the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. There are other forms of, in a way, suppressing violence, the formation of protectorates. One might think that certain European powers would like to turn Libya into some form of modern protectorate because that would help end the chaos there, even though it would be seen as a very colonial measure. A common feature in balance of power politics is deterrence. Deterrence means you say before military confrontation what the consequences will be of aggression. And you formulate it in such a way that the other side should understand that it is very unwise to commit acts of aggression, because that other side will get a lot of damage, which will wipe out any advantages that can be gained by aggression. Deterrence is warning of serious consequences in case of misbehavior. It's a very general principle of making states, but also organizations, and also people behave. We, as human beings, leave certain actions that we sometimes dream of behind because we know it will harm us. There will be punishment, and it's very unwise to step over the rules. We have police, we have the legal system, we have social control. Now, deterrence is this application to the field of military, and it tends to be forgotten that it's a perennial principle because it is very much associated with nuclear deterrence, but it also applies to conventional means of war. And then an entirely different principle, some political scientists advocate this, is that the only system that works is a benevolent hegemony. The world is so chaotic that we need a big power keeping some degree of order. Read the United States. If that is the right solution, how long will it work? By the end of this century, the United States is 500 million people. India, 1.7 billion. China, 1.1. Nigeria, 750 million. One and a half time as large as the United States, and larger than all of the European Union is by that time. So the world we live in is going to change. Now, hegemony may sound not so unpleasant as some form of dictatorship. The Roman Empire was a hegemonic political system. And those who rebelled got the Roman legions sent to them, and the rebellions were put down till the empire collapsed itself because of the rising power of what the Romans regarded as the German hordes, who finally conquered Rome. Now, this is all very negative, and it is called negative peace. Let's end more positive. Positive peace building is, of course, doing more than creating the absence of violence. It means building a society which has all the means for peaceful conflict resolution. First of all, if you don't have institutions which take care of this, and if you are smart and you don't want all the damage of violent confrontation, you negotiate. Rather than going into a fist fight with your neighbor, you negotiate about where the garden posts should be. If you can't solve it by negotiation, you ask for a mediator, a wise person or a powerful person who can also twist some arms, to find a solution and talk sense to both or more than two sides, like the American diplomat Holbrooke, who negotiated the Dayton Peace Agreement between the Croats, the Bosniaks, and the Serbs. And he could do that for some reasons. First of all, he took a very tough line. Secondly, the United States had first fired a number of cruise missiles at Serb military targets. So the Serbs knew it was time to negotiate. And the warring parties were getting exhausted. The Serbs had reached most of their war gains, most war goals, and were running short of military to preserve them. And the Bosniaks were increasing their manpower and their military means because they got a lot of arms from Iran and China. And the Serbs were getting a bit worried about that. What if the tide turns against us? So they knew it was time to negotiate. And then a negotiator, a mediator on behalf of a big power helped. Mediation is not just some objective refugee business. A good mediator also can twist some arms and also distribute benefits. If you sign, you'll get this. If you don't sign, it'll become very unpleasant for you. And that is often said next to the negotiation table in private deals with the parties that are to be mediated. Then,
sorry, but if you want to catch the train just before 10, it's almost time.
Yes, yeah. I had a few minutes left the previous time, and I walk fast. So I'll finish slide number 45. You can go from mediation to arbitration, have some agreed rules beforehand to settle your conflict. You can go to the court in The Hague. Few countries do. It's the cheapest way to get a solution. And once you have negative peace and some form of solution, the time comes for reconstruction of all the damage done by the violent conflict, for peace building, for state building, for step-by-step building legal order. And I put legal order in front of fair and free elections because some people think that once you organize elections, you have democracy and peace. Not so. Some elections lead to electing war criminals to president. And it is then one man, one vote, one time. And then new dictatorship. And before elections can really be an element of peaceful conflict resolution, you need to have a fairly good legal order, you need to have electoral law, you need to train political parties how to compete decently, you need to have laws guaranteeing fairly free media. We, most of us West Europeans, think all that comes naturally. Not so. We forget that in the very recent past, in 1945, the Netherlands had a military government after peace to make sure the country would not fall into disorder. And only a year later, we had parliamentary elections and an elected democratic government. So things have to go in a certain order. You cannot all of a sudden have a just democratic system. It has to be built step by step. And the way it has to be built, it can also be disintegrating if you don't take care of the institutions needed for a democratic order. If you think that democracy is public opinion polls and doing what the majority of the day says, that's not democratic government because it's extremely inconsistent. Parliamentary democracy is quite a different thing. Once you have a legal order which is complete, then by definition, you also have human rights protection because that is national and international law. We are all bound by international law, human rights treaties. It's an obligation. Many countries do not implement that obligation, but fortunately, we live in countries where that obligation is implemented. So that leads to human rights protection, and then you have a complete and peaceful political system. And that's perhaps a good end of today's lecture. Thank you.